Hi, I'm Dr. Joanne McDonald, and I'm with the Reproductive Mental Health Service and Dalhousie University in Halifax, Nova Scotia, Canada. Welcome to one in a series of video learning modules that we've prepared on topics in maternal or mother's mental health. The topic we're going to consider in this module is anxiety in mothers. What do we see in both pregnant and postpartum women in terms of anxiety disorders and spectrum? Some people would say, well, don't all mothers worry? Isn't it a part of mothering to worry? When will we know when worry is a problem? Well, having a concern for your child or for your family in general and thinking ahead are really typical for dedicated mothers. But being ruled by your worry, we don't think, is a necessary part of motherhood. Constant worry and always thinking ahead about things that might go wrong, really negative predictions and negative considerations for the future, which some people think is just risk management, can be a sign of an anxiety problem, though called generalized anxiety disorder, shortened to GAD. GAD is really marked by difficulty stopping the worrying thoughts, by the associated physical discomfort and tension that comes with the constant worry, and by interfering with positive experiences and perceptions of those experiences. Here's a fast fact. Anxiety is, of course, our body and our mind's natural response to fear and the risk of being harmed in some way. Sometimes this is described as the flight or fight reaction and is thought to be really basic to both humans and animals, in fact. But an anxiety problem really comes when the fear is much bigger than the likely or the real here and now risk or threat. So the response is a natural one, but it's being triggered off in a situation that really doesn't warrant the response in the first place, or certainly not that degree of fear and arousal. How does anxiety feel in the body? Well, common experiences are of muscle tension generally. People will say, I just sort of feel sore all over at times, or they'll notice when they're anxious that they always get that particular sense of pain and tension in a particular muscle in their body. Sometimes this is the cause of stress headaches, for example. Shortness of breath is common, or a sensation of not having enough air, tightness in the chest, nausea, generalized sort of stomach upset, dizziness, fatigue, and pain, such as I mentioned, headache, or a common one is also abdominal pain or discomfort. How does anxiety present in the mind? Well, we mentioned the constant full-on worrying thoughts. Preoccupation with negative future events, planning for possible future harm and difficulty all the time, a racing pace on negative thoughts, but at times a slowed pace for other needs. So anxious people will say, I have difficulty concentrating. I'm going over and over and over a situation or a problem or a possibility in my mind, but I can't seem to make a plan or I can't seem to decide or settle on the plan. How does anxiety affect behavior? Well, mothers who spend more time on worry and strategies against possible future harm are really using up most of their thinking time on this. And they may avoid positive situations influenced by a possible problem or a sign of worry. So for instance, let's say there's a gathering in the neighborhood and one of the possibilities is they would go meet some new people, really find they had a lot in common and really enjoy the experience. If they're anxious, they'll think about, I might not fit in, or I might not be wearing the right thing, or what if I go there and I get sort of overwhelmed and don't know what to say, or I have a panic attack like I've had in the past, then that's going to be horrible and embarrassing. So probably it's better if I just don't go. Yeah, well, I have a lot of work to do at home, so maybe another time. I just won't go this particular time to the neighborhood barbecue. And what doesn't get recognized is the positive experience that could have been missed out on while the need to protect oneself from the feared possible negative event is sort of so high. And that, in times as well, women with high levels of anxiety may turn to some strategies really to lessen their anxiety that we think, in fact, may be a negative for them. Certainly some women will misuse substances in this circumstance. They may spend time with people that are not really encouraging and positive for them because they feel safe with those people and they reinforce their anxiety. Or they may just begin to utilize internal coping strategies, such as social withdrawal, or constant preoccupation or focus on tasks rather than pleasure as a way to manage their anxiety, all of which have negative consequences for general emotional health. And they may communicate unnecessary anxiety to others in their life, particularly their children. So one of the things in families when anxiety problems run from generation to generation is there's usually a mixture of both biological or genetic risk for the anxiety disorder, but also a lot of reinforcement that anxiety is going to come to you. There's lots in the world to fear, and you really have to be on the watch for this and protect yourself and others around you from unnecessary anxiety. But now, what about if there are real problems and worries in pregnancy or with a woman's child? Because we know that pregnancy and child rearing brings a lot of natural situations of difficulty, of illness, of concern. And in no way are we trying to say that anxious thoughts or feelings or responses are abnormal in and of themselves. But if you have a real dilemma or problem in front of you, you need all of your energy, both physically and emotionally and in terms of your thinking, to really figure out what's the best response from you to this real problem in your life. So if you have a child that's in a special care unit, you want to be able to sort of be ready to assist in the care of that child, to be able to be present emotionally, connect with that child, and not be drained and preoccupied by anxious thoughts and all the things that you can't control, so that you're ready. So we always say that worry and concern are natural and difficulty, but anxious thoughts and responses become a problem when they interfere with the calm, the function, decision-making, and energy to react as needed. Mothers need to be ready to respond. And our children really need this response from us and need us to be sort of at our best and as clear as we possibly can be. The sudden experience of fear and intense body responses, sometimes without any warning, is how panic disorder can present. It can feel like a true health crisis in the body. Anxiety can really trigger very powerful responses in our respiratory and breathing systems, in our cardiovascular systems. It can change skin tone, can affect a lot of body systems. There doesn't have to be something else wrong with the body for us to have those signs and symptoms. It can be anxiety alone that brings on those physical realities. If you have earlier life experiences of genuine fear or difficulty or trauma, it can certainly prime your anxiety response. And this, when you think about it, is kind of common sense. If you've been frightened a lot as a child or you weren't in a very secure or calm situation, you're going to be sort of a little quicker on that fight or flight response. You're going to have needed to employ it a lot more as a child, and you're going to have felt the need to protect yourself. And if you didn't have a calm, highly functioning adult to help you develop adaptive responses to fear or trauma, you may be particularly sensitive to anxiety as a symptom or, you know, as a response. We also think that people vary in how highly or easily aroused that they can become in a fearful situation, and that this may just be a difference between us sort of physically from one person to another. Post-traumatic stress responses are a kind of anxiety presentation that will come from sudden spontaneous re-triggering of a previous real experience or trauma. This is called PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, when the response happens frequently in the here and now to something that was a previous real lived experience of trauma or a fear. PTSD symptoms can occur with many different kinds of trauma and can include body anxiety, sudden visual or sensory feedback flashbacks to the traumatic event, sudden startle, even when, you know, there's nothing fearful happening but somebody enters a room quickly, that kind of thing, and the person has a sort of overreactive startle response. Or they can have the opposite in combination with the startle, that at times they feel also almost like they're behind a kind of protective blanket of numbness, that there's a low reactivity in certain kinds of situations, particularly emotionally. We tend to think that this is a protective response, an unconscious response to sort of dull down that excessive response from the past. Headache is very common, as is a constant sense of readiness, as though there is an immediate crisis or danger. So in PTSD, the danger in the past was specific and real, but that danger isn't here now. but the person is responding as though it is or that it could happen imminently. Any circumstance in the here or now that mimics in some way or kind of has some element in it that is an echo of a trauma or a real feared circumstance in the past is really much more likely to trigger a PTSD spectrum response. Obsessive compulsive disorder or obsessive compulsive symptoms or traits are another sign of anxiety problem that we see in mothers, both in pregnancy and in the postpartum. These are often associated with compulsive behaviors of checking, counting, organizing, or cleaning. That's a response to anxiety, which has now become a dominating need to continue the behavior even when the danger itself isn't present. When a woman can't repeat those behaviors that have become a habit for her, a habit that reduces her anxiety, anxiety increases in a rebound kind of way, as though a real danger were coming. OCD and associated symptoms can be very time-consuming, create tremendous fatigue for the woman, and interfere again with her time for positive thoughts and activities. Sometimes for some women, the routines become a sort of a daily schedule in themselves. And the strategy begins to control the woman, not control the anxiety, and spill over into becoming a controlling experience for those close to the woman, particularly her partner and her family and friends. Obsessions are frequent repetitive thoughts, sometimes repetitive images. So some people are more visual than verbal, and so obsessional ideas come to them sort of in the picture of an idea as opposed to the word-laden thought of an idea. Compulsions, though, are forced repeated activities that the person feels they must do to sort of reduce anxiety. Examples, again, are checking for safety. All of us might check once, maybe twice, to make sure we turn the stove off, but checking beyond that and having to go back and double check and triple check can be a sign of obsessive compulsive spectrum problem, as can be repeated and forced cleaning, including hand washing, counting, and the need to order things, not be able to settle unless they are in that order. So what can be done generally about anxiety in mothers? Well, general stress reduction, self-care, and mindfulness practices can help reduce the body tension and anxiety a great deal. Whereas cognitive behavioral therapy will help reduce the anxious thinking and the consequent behaviors. There's also a lot of resources out there for self-management with CBT, but the assistance of a therapist, if available, who's trained in CBT, can really help you stay on track with those very tough changes in terms of the way we think and respond. It's pretty much human nature to have habits. And when we have habits that are really limiting us in the way that some anxiety disorders do, sometimes we need sort of a coach or someone to guide us along the way, even if we understand the concepts when we read a self-management guide. Medications of various types can also be very helpful at times to reduce what I call turn down the volume on the anxious symptoms, both the anxious thoughts, the intensity of them, how frequently they're coming. Certainly can help tune down the body's response because anybody who's ever had their heart rate increase without sort of knowing why will say that, you know, your heart rate goes up and then you secondarily begin to feel anxious. So sometimes we have to do both things. We have to turn down the dial on the body, turn down the dial on the thinking and the nature of it and the pace of it to really begin to tackle how much of our life has been taken over by anxiety. Exercise, nutrition, and focus on positive thoughts and activities are really important as competition for those sort of negative thinking and responses of anxiety for that mother's time and focus. Key resource for you is a recently developed a self-directed education and intervention model, very simple kinds of cognitive and relaxation techniques, is on the Anxiety BC website. And if you go to the main website, you can get to it by finding the perinatal resources or with the URL address you see here. It involves, as I said, self-help for anxiety for moms and how to love and care for those around you without worry and tension. Being a mother should be a positive, creative exercise where lots of attention and concern is given to your family life, but it doesn't have to be accompanied by anxiety and worry. The goal, remember, of reducing anxiety for mothers is really to increase their readiness and their resilience, to make them even more effective in that role than they are when so much of their energy is consumed with the anxious symptoms. And a ready, calm, and positive mom is really thought to be able to raise more strategic and confident children. We want to be problem solvers in our lives, and we want to have all of our energies and capacity to focus on that, particularly when the problems are many, or they're large, or they're coming at us quickly. So a take-home point is that mothers need tools in difficult times, and less anxiety leaves more room for good planning as a tool, flexibility, energy for readiness in crisis, and a toolkit of strategies to try. So thanks for listening. This again is a learning module in a series developed for the Mother's Mental Health Toolkit Project, and our aim is to promote knowledge and advocacy for mothers' mental health through a frontline community and service support providers. Thanks for listening.